Pablo Rochat has been described as a prankster with a knack for social media originality. In the past, you might have seen his creative collaborations with the pigeons of his local neighborhood in San Francisco, which are equal parts hilarious and heartwarming. Or his life-sized AirPod sticker prank, which capitalized on people's anxieties around dropping their earphones. Yet he's also worked with some of the biggest brands and artists in the world. His recent projects include directing a music video for Drake and classically tongue-in-cheek campaigns for the likes of Balenciaga and Hermes. He's also created illustrations and animations for the New York Times and New York Magazine, among many others. I'm delighted to say that Pablo is our next guest for this month's Nicer Tuesdays. Hi, Pablo. How are you?
Hi there. How's it going?
I'm very well, thanks.
Yeah, thanks for having me, Matt. Good.
Fantastic. Yeah, well, thanks so much for joining us. And yeah, it's great to have you here. So I guess unlike Aurelia, you're going to not be doing a talk today. Instead, I get to ask you lots of questions and also everyone in the audience as well. Please feel free as ever to pop your questions in the chat and I'll do my best to ask Pablo for you. But Pablo, I guess my first question is, you know, you've done, as I mentioned, commissions for the New York Times, music videos for Drake. You've dreamed up campaigns for Balenciaga. The projects are all really diverse, but does your approach differ for each, or are there certain processes and steps you kind of tend to take for every creative project, every creative brief?
I think it's funny. I think I approach everything pretty similarly. Most of the time I'm being approached by a client to create some sort of creative visual communication for whatever it is, whether it be a product, or a song that I need to make a music video for. I'm trying to like communicate visually in creative ways, and that's what I'm always trying to do. So whatever it is, whatever I get briefed on, I always start by going to my notebook and writing down as many ideas as possible, while researching, you know, what has Balenciaga done before in the past? What can I add that's new? So it's important to kind of understand what's been done before, just in case I, you know, might have the same ideas what's been done before, or I realize this client hasn't done a certain thing before, so that can inform a series of ideas. So it always starts with me just sketching as many ideas as possible in my notebook. I can show you here. It's just I separate the page into 10 squares, and then each day I'll write 10 ideas. And they're basically ideas for what the final product could be. So is the more I iterate, the more ideas I produce, the better chances I have of having a good idea that I'm excited about. And from there, the production is a whole nother thing. You figure out how to produce something. But the creative process is really similar for every project. Mm-hmm.
It's so interesting to hear that it starts with a sketchbook and it almost starts in that very kind of traditional way, and then the outcomes are so kind of so diverse and so creative at the other end.
So I used to, you know, start in Photoshop, like pull an image of the product that needs to be advertised or the artist that needs to be featured in a music video or whatever, and then I would like Photoshop a scene. But I would get really, I'd waste a lot of time trying to being distracted by actual visual elements and not be focused on what the actual idea was. So for the past few years, I've just always started with a pen and paper. So the idea, it starts with the idea, not so much the actual visual material.
Interesting. Okay. And then everything feeds on from there. I should explain to the audience that we're going to be watching, I guess, a few videos and a few pieces of Pablo's work. So right now we're looking at the Drake music video that I mentioned earlier. But yeah, there will be other stuff coming up as well. Pablo, humor is such a key ingredient to all your projects, or at least the vast majority of them. It's such a hard thing to give advice about and to explain, because there's almost this assumption that, you know, you're either funny or you're not. But do you find there are ways to approach a problem or a project to kind of coax out the humor? Is there a bit of a recipe to getting humor into a project?
I wish there was. I mean, I'm just constantly in pursuit of a funny idea or a funny solution to a problem. Since I was a kid, I've always wanted to make my friends laugh, make my family laugh. I've felt that if I were to make something and then someone laughs or smiles, like that's all I need. That's the end result. And so I don't know. I might be a little naturally like more silly, funny than most people, but I really think what's produces the most creative, like funny work is having done a lot of, published a lot of stuff. So the more you practice, the better you get, just like anything else. There could be someone who's like naturally very funny and just hasn't done any creative work or hasn't like stood up and told a joke in front of someone, and their material is not going to work as well as someone who's less funny naturally, but who's done it for years and years and understands how an audience receives something. So basically the more I produce, actually more importantly, the more I publish and put something in front of an audience, the more I understand what is funny and what isn't based on the reaction. Because a lot of times I will have something on a piece of paper that I wrote down just by myself in my office that I think is genius, funny, it's going to be awesome. And then I make it and it actually falls flat. I'm always surprised of what doesn't work and sometimes what does work. But over time, it just takes practice to be funny, I think.
That's a really interesting way of putting it. And I guess this is a really good example of the collaborations I mentioned with your pigeons in I think it's Chinatown in San Francisco. I guess one thing I wanted to talk about. Oh, sorry. Yeah, please go on.
I'm also just a big fan of comedy and entertainment. And so I'm just always learning from being an audience member as well. And you can kind of get to understand why, if you kind of think about it closer, like why something made me laugh and whatnot. So you can analyze outside of humor as well, not just your own.
Yeah, interesting. I was going to ask you about kind of, because I guess when you look at your website, there's a whole section of things that you call freebies, which I think are just kind of little experiments and little fun things that you wanted to kind of share with your audience. It's a really big, it's almost an advertisement for not necessarily waiting for the project to come to you, right? And just constantly making stuff, and you'll eventually find something that could become a bigger project at some point or feed into another project.
Yeah, I mean, 100%. I mean, where I'm at now and the work that I do now for business, for clients, it all stems from me doing my personal work. I was working in advertising agencies and internally at companies in the past. And I was always doing independent projects because oftentimes the ideas that I think are more interesting that I come up with are less likely to be sold in a presentation to a client. What I found is that if I just publish it on my own and prove that there's an audience and prove that based on the engagement that people are interested in whatever creative idea I have, that's kind of a way of selling myself as a creative to a client. They see me publicly doing something already and they see it working, and that gives them the confidence to maybe reach out to me to do my, to work with me. So the personal projects always feed the professional projects in that way. And so it's always important for me, even if, oftentimes I do get busy with client work, to always kind of remember that the only reason why I'm getting client work is because of the personal work that I did.
Yeah, it's such a valuable way of thinking about it. And I think, a good lesson for anyone who wants to be kind of, creative and get the big project is kind of to keep creating, I guess, in many ways, if you can, of course. We've had some great questions through from the audience already, which is fantastic. And please do keep them coming. A couple of people are asked, like, how do you keep inspired? How do you overcome creative block? I guess they're kind of two sides of the same question. Any kind of insights into what happens when you're feeling slightly uninspired and what you do then?
Yeah, I'm glad that was a question, because I think some people, I get messages and emails about this, and some people might think that it's like, it's easy or I'm good at it. But I'm good at coming up with a creative idea or whatever, but it's never gotten easier. I've just decided to spend my entire day working on producing creative work. So it's really about the time that I put in. And The creative blocks happen all the time, and it's like more rare that I don't have a creative block than I do. And so, you know, I have to give myself the assignment to have a certain amount of ideas per day, because I can easily kind of slack off if I feel like I'm not putting anything good on paper. And so let's just wait till tomorrow. But I think that if you were just to take an hour break, walk, or go exercise or do something else and come back, the creative block will have eased a bit. And you just have to show up to your desk. It's challenged. It's hard work. It looks fun, and it is. I'm very lucky to be doing what I'm doing, but I spend an abnormal amount of time in my notebook trying to think of a prank or a silly idea. And oftentimes I think that my success and my creative work comes not just from, you know, having creative ideas, but actually being willing to try something really silly out in the world. I think a lot of people have good ideas and clever jokes just to themselves or with their friends, but I've kind of dedicated a lot of my time during the day to go and actually make the stuff. And so it's just about spending time with it. And yeah, but you know, everyone kind of works in their own way. So, but I'm obsessed with trying to get over creative blocks. It's like my number one enemy, and it happens every day. So for me, honestly, it's like exercise and taking a nap. Yeah.
Honestly, I think so many people will be very relieved to hear that even you get creative block and even you struggle with it. So that's great.
Yeah, I don't
great,
post about great it. To hear. I don't really post about the creative block because I'm not sure what I would post, and I don't want anyone to boohoo me, but it happens. It's happening. Yeah.
It's happening. Relief for everyone, I'm sure. There's a really interesting question here from Leonora. Sorry, I'm not sure if I've said that right. Apologies if I haven't. How did you make the transition from working in an ad agency to doing your own projects? Because I think that is a really difficult transition to make for lots of people, even if they do want to do it. So yeah, how did you find that transition from ad agency onto own stuff?
Well, first of all, I learned so much at the advertising agency. Not only did I make really good friends that are like-minded, and also learned how to actually have an idea and sell it through to a client, which is a super important skill, I think. Basically, like I said before, I was coming up ideas for briefs that I was getting as an art director in the agency. And oftentimes the ideas that I thought were really exciting were kind of too offbeat for the client, or something that kind of they weren't familiar with in a way. And so my favorite ideas weren't really getting sold through, but I still wanted to make them. And so, you know, I posted on Instagram, posted on Reddit, on YouTube, and, you know, you have your friends that you're posting to at first, and then your friends might share it with another friend. And just the more time that you spend publishing personal work, inevitably more people will become aware of it. But also you should be aware of what your audience is liking and not liking if you do want to entertain people with a personal idea. It's important to test them and, you know, move in a direction where you are both excited about the work that you're making, and also other people are excited to experience the work that you're making. So basically after hours, after, you know, or at lunch, or when I'm pretending to work on a client project, I'm just making a post for Instagram or collaborating with a friend to post something on YouTube. It's just about putting in the time and actually publishing stuff. That's the hardest part because it is scary. But you really don't have much to lose. You have a lot to learn when you do publish your personal projects.
I think there's a really interesting point that you've made kind of in the last couple of answers, which is really, you know, we do focus a lot on ideas, but actually the challenging part is the going out and making it. And then there's another challenging part, which is putting it out into the world once you've done that.
Yeah. And, you know, I think a lot of creative block is fear in a way that I won't have another good idea, or if I decide not to post something, I'm it's a lot of it's based in fear that no one else is going to like it. So it is about overcoming that. And then you can always create pseudonyms or another Instagram account to just test out ideas, or just text it to a friend. But even texting it to a friend doesn't count, I don't think, because they're going to might be nice to you regardless. And so publishing it to strangers is like the most valuable learning that you can get from producing your own creative work.
And I guess, do you have to accept that, you know, sometimes you're going to get it wrong, sometimes you're going to make something that people won't like or will take issue with, particularly as your audience grows, as yours has?
Yeah. I mean, I'm not making hits every day. Some work that I post in the future is not going to be as good as the work that I've done in the past. Even though it's subjective, I might think about that for myself. And I do get down about it because I work hard to try to entertain people. And when people are less entertained from something that I make, than something I'd made before, then, you know, I try to think like, why didn't that work? And so, you do have to deal with the pain of sucking a little, for, I think, your whole career. You just kind of have to get used to it, and it's never feels good, but it's a part of it, and it's worth it in the end.
Yeah, definitely. Sorry, Pablo, I'm finding this, I've never been more distracted by what's been on the screen while doing a Q&A before. It's absolutely amazing watching your work coming up. We've had a really good question from Adrienne. How do you approach working across various mediums? I guess, you know, we talked at the beginning that you've done music videos, you've done illustration work, you've done animations, you've done kind of things out in the real world, you know. How do you find working across so many different disciplines?
Yeah, I think... I love it. It's just a new opportunity to do something creative. Sometimes it can get a little stale to work in the same medium, at least for me. I'm pretty, you know, ADD in that I like to switch my focus and try a new material or media. And so it suits the type of work that I like to do, which is a variety of things. And then, you know, in the beginning, it's scary because maybe I was just mostly making kind of funny videos or animations, and then suddenly a newspaper asked me to do illustrations, something I haven't done before. And then, you know, you go through the process and you get it done, and then you realize, oh wait, I can convert my creative thinking from one medium to another medium. So it's just then a music video happens, and I feel a little bit more comfortable tackling that problem because I've tackled new problems before. And so just the more variety of projects that I do, the more comfortable I get with doing a variety of projects. But, you know, like I said, it's always scary, but there's always a chance of sucking, of doing shitty work. There's always that chance. And I'm always scared of that.
Yeah, so I'm sure we all are as well. Yeah, no, very true. There's a question here from Harriet who says, could you talk a bit more about your 10 ideas a day sketchbook? It would be good to get a bit more detail on, are they all in one theme, those ideas for the day, or are they kind of very distinct? You're just kind of letting your mind go completely free. What does that look like, those 10 ideas a day?
Yeah, so I do it both for client work and personal work, where if I were to get a brief from a client, let's say they have it's like Nike, and they have a shoe that, like a basketball shoe, that they want me to create a video for, or whatever it may be. I get a piece of paper, I draw a grid of 10 squares, and then I'll say, okay, today I'm gonna have 10 ideas about this shoe. It just forces me to not be precious with the first idea, or get too attached with the first idea, or get too discouraged by a bad first idea, and knowing that I have 9 other opportunities to have a good one that day. And so basically, you know, I write I draw, because I'm kind of a visual, and the end result is going to be visual. So I draw out what the idea could be, like the shoe is flying through the air and going from one town to another. That idea, but like, okay, that's the idea. So I draw a shoe flying in the air, and then I write The shoe is going to fly in the air from one town to another town. And then, okay, next idea, whatever the next idea is. So it forces me not to be spend too much time on one idea and to have multiple ideas, because I'm always surprised by what can come next, especially after having maybe a couple bad ideas. Good ideas are feel like they may be on the way. So it's just quantity with a mix of a little bit of quality. And basically, the more ideas I put down, the more chances I have of having a good one. And then you get to go back the next day and look at it with fresh eye and kind of do your own editing. And then also, I have a catalog of like thousands of ideas now that, you know, I've done like two shoe campaigns already. So I can go back and see 50. If I get another project about a shoe, for example, I already have done some thinking about that and I can revisit. So I have a library of ideas.
That's really, yeah, that's very, very interesting. And I think, yeah, just great to hear as well that it's kind of taking the pressure off yourself, isn't it? That's the most important thing. Because I think that pressure that you put on yourself can be so difficult.
One important thing that I kind of talked about, but I think it's really important, is to give yourself permission to write down bad ideas, because oftentimes I get stuck and find myself in some sort of creative block when I am not coming up with any good ideas in my head. And so the page is left blank. So if I literally force myself to write down a few bad ideas, and it's I'm even embarrassed by myself to have like a bad idea or an idea that I've seen before or whatever, it actually loosens you up and kind of gets the ideas flowing and better ideas coming. So writing down bad ideas is harder than you think, but it actually helps get through the creative process.
I wanted to ask a question about kind of labels, and I think in the press you've been called everything from a prankster to a trolling expert at one point. What do you make of those labels? I mean, do you agree that kind of describes what you're doing sometimes, or would you prefer people not to use those kind of terms? How do you feel about them?
I don't mind. I think it's like, I admire a great prank, a good troll that I see online. So, you know, I don't think I'm not doing that all the time, but oftentimes I do have an idea for a prank, and every once in a while I will do one and publish it. And so those labels will come with that kind of work. And I don't really mind. It's always been hard to kind of put on a label on what I do, kind of defer. It's different for each job, but I don't think the labels really matter. It's more just like what is the work? Because that's what people are going to see anyways.
Definitely.
But yeah, I love pranks.
Really interesting. Love pranks. Really good question from Joseph here. How do you make sure you have creative wriggle room with a brief? Or how do you deal with a client who's close-minded?
Well, for a client who's close-minded, I think it's important, because they're coming to you for a service, that you nail the brief as best you can based on what they are asking, and then give them options and for something outside the box. So I wouldn't come to a client with a idea that's outside of the brief, because I think it's better, unless I have an idea that's also inside the brief that they were kind of looking for in the beginning. So I would both satisfy their appetite for whatever idea they briefed you for, but then also introduce a new idea. And then I'll put that at the end of a presentation, just so I cover all the bases. I think it's important to cover their bases, especially like I really do want to provide a good creative service. And sometimes it's not going to be the most interesting work, but you can always, you're in the meeting already. You can pitch some additional ideas afterwards.
Fantastic. I guess one final question, because I think we're slightly running out of time, but we've had a couple of questions that I guess kind of fit into the same kind of, I guess, basket. Is there anyone you'd like to work with in the future? Is a question from Adrienne. And then, I guess I was kind of thinking, is there a particular project you'd love to do that you haven't yet had the opportunity to do? So two questions there. Who would you like to collaborate with, and what kind of project do you want to do?
I don't know. There's probably a lot of people. You know, I'm a big fan of music. Obviously, working with Drake was a dream. I don't know. I can't answer that right now, but like working with musicians is fun. And then in terms of like general projects that I might want to pursue this year or in the future is most of what I do right now just comes in the form of like a digital asset, whether it be, you know, a video or an image. I do kind of want to explore more physical projects, whether it be, you know, a mural or I think a clothing line. I do like,
yeah, amazing. Absolutely.
The idea of producing apparel. So yeah.
Fantastic. Pablo, listen, thank you so much for joining us. That was absolutely amazing. I'm afraid we're going to have to leave it there, but yeah, thank you for joining us on Nicer Tuesdays online. Everyone
Thanks,
else,
Matt. That was awesome.